Welcome to The Explainer. Today, we're going to talk about a single, really powerful number that helps economists understand and even predict how we all spend our money. It's called the Marginal Propensity to Consume, or MPC for short.
I know, it kind of sounds like something out of a sci-fi movie, right? How can one little number possibly sum up the spending habits of millions of different people? Well, stick with me, because that's exactly the mystery we're going to unravel today.
Okay, so let's get into it. And whoa, when you first look at this table from our source material, it's a lot. I get it. All these columns, all these numbers, it looks complicated. But don't worry about it. We're going to build this thing from the ground up, one simple piece at a time. I promise.
All right, first things first. Before we can even talk about spending money, we have to figure out how much money is actually on the table to be spent in the first place. And that brings us to our very first concept.
It's called disposable income. You can just think of it as your take-home pay, basically. It's the total income of an entire economy. That's the national income, but then you subtract everything that goes to taxes. Whatever is left over, that's the money that people can actually choose to spend or, you know, stick in a savings account.
So let's see how this works with some actual numbers. In our example here, the taxes are just fixed at 80. They don't change. So if the whole economy makes 100, we just knock off that 80 in taxes and we're left with 20 of disposable income. If national income jumps up to 200, we still subtract that same 80 and now we have 120. See, super straightforward.
Okay, so we've got our baseline. We know how to find disposable income. But here's the thing. The really interesting story isn't in those big totals. To get to the MPC, we have to look at the movement between these numbers. We have to start tracking the changes.
It is where that word marginal comes into play. Sounds kind of fancy, but in economics, marginal is actually super simple. It just means the next one or the additional one. We're not asking what people spend in total. We're asking a more specific question. What do people do with the very next dollar they get?
So let's add two new columns to our table to track this. When disposable income goes from 20 up to 120, what's the change? It's 100. And you see that little triangle symbol? That's the Greek letter delta, and it's just shorthand for the change in. So the change in income is 100. At the very same time, consumption went from 116 to 196, so the change in consumption is 80. All we're doing is finding the difference between each row.
All right. This is it. We have all the pieces of the puzzle. We've got the change in our income, and we've got the change in our spending. Now, finally, we are ready to calculate the marginal propensity to consume.
So what is this thing really? It just answers one simple question. If you get an extra dollar of income, how much of that exact dollar are you going to spend? It's the fraction or the proportion of any new money that goes straight to buying stuff.
And the formula to figure it out is, well, it's beautiful because it's so simple. You just take the change in consumption, that's our delta C, and you divide it by the change in disposable income, our delta YD. That is it. That's the entire calculation right there.
Now let's just plug our numbers in. For that first row, the change in consumption was 80, and the change in income was 100. So what's 80 divided by 100? It's 0.8. Let's check the next one. The change in consumption was 160 divided by a change in income of 200. Hey, that's 0.8 too. You see the pattern here? No matter which rows we look at, it keeps coming out the same.
And there it is, 0.8. This is the number we've been building towards this whole time. It seems simple, but it tells us a really powerful and consistent story about how this economy behaves when it gets a little more cash.
So, we have the number. But so what? A number is just a number until we understand what it really means. What does 0.8 actually tell us about the real world, and, you know, why do economists care so much about it?
This is the key. An MPC of 0.8 translates directly into this very simple idea. It means if the economy as a whole gets one extra dollar, 80 cents of that dollar is going to be spent right away on goods and services. And the other 20 cents? Well, that's what gets saved.
Now, it is really important not to get the MPC mixed up with a similar idea called the average propensity to consume, or APC. The APC looks at total spending as a piece of total income. It's the big picture. But the MPC, what we've been focused on, is all about that next dollar. And that distinction is absolutely critical for policymakers trying to figure out the immediate impact of something like a tax cut.
So let's do a quick recap of our journey. We started with all the income in the economy. We subtracted taxes to find out what people actually have left their disposable income. Then, and this was the key, we zoomed in on the changes between the different income levels. And by dividing the change in spending by the change in income, we found our magic number, 0.8, which simply means 80 cents of every new dollar gets spent.
And this brings us to one last thought. We've been looking at a whole economy, but this idea works for individuals too. So if you got an unexpected $100 tomorrow, how much of it would you spend and how much would you save? That ratio, that's your personal MPC. Something to think about. Thanks for joining us.